So I did an undergraduate degree in mechatronics and robotics. That is really about having different components like electronics, computing, and mechanical structures and bringing them together. So for my PhD, I did some work on robotic physiotherapy. They are devices that make you well when you have things like a brain injury. But from that point, I've gone forward working a lot in exploration robotics, but also more broadly in general robotics and in medical robotics. I lead quite a few different projects at the University of Leeds. So as I guess you know, robotics really is a multidisciplinary subject. So you can't build a robot by being a mechanical engineer. You need to have motors, electronics. So the projects that I lead have people from all disciplines, civil engineering, computer science, all coming together to create these robots to do certain things. You may not know where I come from. I come from the University of Leeds. Leeds is in the kind of middle of the UK, sitting here. It's not far from Manchester. So if any of you are in the UK around there, please do come and see us. We're very much welcome you to show you our lab, what we're doing, what we're up to. About a week ago, we had quite a thick snow in the UK, so it's quite nice to come somewhere quite warm and really feel the heat and energy in the place. So, generally at Leeds, quite a large robotics group, we have different themes. So one theme is robot therapists. Now these are robots that you would wear to recover a lost function. So for example, you have a brain injury, you can't move your arm, you'd wear a robot for a month, 2 months, 3 months, but over time you recover that lost function and therefore you can get rid of the robot and get on with your life. It's a therapy designed to make you recover from your injury. Similar but slightly different is a system of enhanced robots. In this case, you've lost a limb or you've become permanently injured. Now you want a robot to actually make you have a good quality of life forever. So you always use it, you can't grow out of it effectively, but it makes you a better quality of life. Same technologies, well, it's about doing surgery, so operations on people, using robots, really designed to do the least possible damage to you through the surgery, so small incision surgery, that kind of thing. And we also work very much more broadly across general robotics, things like AI, communications, mechanical structures. So these are all the things, the talking of things we need to do to be able to build robots. I want to briefly give you a refresher of robotics generally, just so you understand kind of how we make robots. So the first thing is you have a problem. So it's always driven by a problem. Someone comes to you and says, I want a robot to inspect a pipe. That's your problem. Then you go through, you make some sketches, some drawings, you try and do some things, work out what actually it's going to be. Then you go away and do a mechatronic design. So the first thing is just a drawing, science fiction. The mechatronics design is really about, okay, I need this much force, this much power, thinking about what components you can bring together to make this move. Then, of course, very importantly in robotics, you have to make it, you have to test it. Some areas you can just kind of design it, do a simulation, that's okay. In robotics, if you don't make it, no one believes you, and for good reason, because quite often the design on the computer doesn't actually work. It's very important that you go away, you make it, and do things. This is a beautiful design process, wouldn't that be great? You have an idea, you flow it through, it all works. In reality, when you make robots, it's this kind of crazy thing where you design something, you test it, it doesn't work, you change that part makes another part not work, and you go around in circles for a long period of time, and eventually, hopefully, you find a good solution. So this is what reality is, and no matter how many times I try in my career, trying to get to this beautiful sequential thing, I'm always here. I design it on the computer, I make it, it doesn't work, so it changes. So it's a long-term process, quite challenging. So in terms of making, so you've got design. In terms of manufacturing design, you probably think about let's make things, let's get a saw, let's cut some material, let's kind of use a hammer. These are all very important things to make things. But these days we can manufacture across many scales. So the top scale here, we're making very large component things for cars. This is probably what you think about in terms of manufacturing. You know, big bits of metal being cut and shaped. But we are making very small robots now. And you can manufacture across a very, very small scale, right down almost to kind of the size of particles. So you can do things like using chemicals to remove material, you can use lasers. There are many techniques you can do to make very, very small robots. So as part of the process of building a robot, you need to think about how you're going to make it, of course you have to make it, and think about clever ways of actually manufacturing it, which is often these days not very large metallic kind of cutting and machining, often very sort of chemical etching, that kind of thing. Of course you need a motor, you need a robot to move, so the definition of a robot compared to maybe an AI system, they both have to make decisions and think, but a robot must move. It has to physically interact with the environment. So if you've got a computer simulation, that's not a robot. It must be physical, in the real world, touching, moving, doing things in the real world, very, very important. And to move, you need a motor or some kind of device to make it move. So I've got some three motors here, I'm going to talk briefly about two of them. It will come more obvious later on while I'm doing this. So how do they work? So a brush motor, it works by electromagnetism. So you have a magnet, permanent magnet, and you have a coil of wire, and you energize that with electricity. When you put electricity through it, you make a magnet. Two magnets oppose. So in this case here, these are permanent magnets, bits of material that are magnetic. You power it up. As you do it, you get an opposing force. This will spin around. As it spins around, of course, at a certain point, you're going to get a kind of a stability point where it's going to balance. So you want to reverse the direction of the magnet. So you have this thing here, we have brushes. And what happens, as it spins around, at a certain point, the actual contacts change, you reverse the direction of the magnet, it keeps it going around the same direction. It's called a brush motor because you have a physical contact, a bit of metal touching, it's rubbing the surface. That's quite important. So that's a physical contact, and you can imagine that causes wear and problems like that. So it's a physical touching contact. A different kind of motor is what we call a brushless motor. In this case, it works on the same principle. You have magnets. Magnets attract things. But what's happening is there is no physical contact. You have multiple magnets. So to make this center bit move around, you energize this one first, then this one, and then this one. So it's a sequence of pulses. When you do that, you can make it go round and round and round in the same direction, which is good. But the key thing here is it is brushless. There's no mechanical contact. There's air gaps, air all the way around. So it's good in that respect. The negative side of things is you can't just get a battery and apply a brush. So in the first one, you get a battery from a shop, you stick it on, the motor will spin around. In this case, if you did that, you get to move one small thing. You need a special bit of electronics to make it go around. So it's more complicated, but it has advantages which are quite good. In terms of the autonomy, so robots must be able to go and do things by themselves, make decisions in some sense. So autonomy means you measure something, from that measurement, you make a choice, and then you act upon that choice. So in the industrial context, you have this thing called the sense, think, act cycle. So a measurement, be it a camera, a sensor, measures something, you do some stuff here to work out what to do, and then you give a command to the motor. It's a very much of a structured thing, it has one choice, great for simple, simple tasks like an industry, but it has limitations, it can't do very complicated things. So another kind of approach you could do is what we have behavior-based robots. This is getting much more complicated now. So things like robot vacuum cleaners work into this kind of approach here. So what happens is, again, you sense what's going on, but now the difference is you have a different choices. So rather than just sensing and doing a particular task, here you can choose different things. So you sense something, it can be you go and explore, it could be stop what you're doing, it could be whatever it might be. So you have different types of things it can do. And each one of these is triggered based upon the sensing. It's a much more complex, much more capable system. It reacts very well to unknown external environments. So if you're in the real world, sometimes you get strange sensor data. It's good for that. So like I say, it's usually very common for things like robot vacuum cleaners, where they have to cope with many things going on. The downside here is that it's very hard to predict exactly what it will do for a given situation. So it has choices, it's hard to understand exactly what it's going to do. So if you want to do an incredibly safe robot, for example, in a nuclear power station, you want it to do a certain thing, it has to do that absolutely precisely, this is not good. because it might make a choice. There might be some subtle things about what it sees. It's very hard to model. It might make a different choice than you expect, and that can be very bad. So, two different structures. The first one is much more for a guaranteed operation. It will be, you know what it's going to do, depending on what it senses. We talked about autonomy. Autonomy being a robot that can actually do its own thing. Very importantly, autonomy is not autonomous or not autonomous. There are levels of autonomy. So let's think about a radio-controlled car. Radio-controlled car, on the floor, I drive it. That is not autonomous. I am fully in control. There's no autonomy there. That's autonomy level one. There's no computer, no assistance. I'm fully in control. It's probably got some kind of system there, like some motors and things, but I'm fully in control. We can go up the autonomy ladder, if you like. So if we go up to autonomy 5, which is halfway, at this point, the computer is going to say to you, I want to go there, I'm going to go, I'm going to get you a cup of tea. And you say, yes, that's a good idea, or no, that's not a good idea. So you're still in full control, but the computer is suggesting to you things it thinks it should do. So you have the final say, but the computer is suggesting things. So that sounds quite useful, quite helpful. We can go more towards autonomy, we can carry on going. If we go to number 7, for example, number 7, what's happening is, the robot is doing something, and then saying to you later on, oh, by the way, did you know I moved your car, or I mowed your lawn? So it's doing it by itself, but then it's deciding later on to tell you. So it's interacting with you, which is good, but you're not giving it permission, it does what it wants, and then tell you what it's done. Number 9 is really kind of scary, I guess, anyways. In this case, the robot will tell you what it's done only if it wants to. So it might do something and then go, actually, I'm not going to tell you that. And you can't force it, so it's going to be a different level of autonomy. And number 10, we never want to get to. Number 10 is the robot does whatever it wants and never tells you what it's doing. That's kind of like a person, effectively. We really don't want that. So autonomy is not just yes or no. There are different levels. And of course, we should aim really, I guess we're aiming for kind of some kind of maybe 7 or 8, where it's very, very capable, but we're still in full control, which is very important for full control. So this autonomy discussion leads us quite well into some ethical things about robots. So what about robots? How should they be used? So in the United Kingdom, we did some work on this. We came up with some different rules on the principles of autonomy. The first one's quite obvious, that you should not design robots to kill people. That's probably a good ethical thing. Ideally, the real ideal world, you shouldn't do that. That's what we should do. Also, that it's always going to be a human that is responsible for what a robot does. So a robot's action somewhere has someone responsible for it. It's not doing its own decisions. It is always answerable to someone, quite important. If we carry going down, this one's quite interesting. So there's lots of work in robotics around making people who are elderly, who are frail, who have mental problems, making them feel better by giving them robot animals, effectively. So it's a kind of a robot toy. I've had a few of these things. They're shaped like animals, like seals, that kind of thing. And they're really nice. You hold them, you stroke them, they make nice, cute sounds. You know, they're nice. And they can be really reassuring to people who are elderly. They can be a companion, they can be company, they can be reassuring. But the really important thing here is that the people who are doing this never think they are actually real. So there's a duty of care for whoever's doing this to make sure the person understands it's not alive. It is something that's nice, like a toy, but it's not actually real. So we always should make sure that robots are artifacts, they're not trying to trick someone into thinking they are real people. Of course, mostly right now, we wouldn't be convinced, but people who are elderly and frail think it could be. And when you hold one of these things, like I say, when you hold them, they're really cute, they're nice. You know, you don't want to put it down, you have to put it back, it's just really cute. The last one is a kind of a quite important point. Especially towards autonomous cars these days, but more generally, it should always be possible to find out legally who is responsible for a robot. If you build an autonomous car, that autonomous car drives into a house, your house, how do you get your money back? Is it the person who's sitting in the car? Very much autonomous, nobody's driving it. Is it the person sitting in the car? Is it the person who made the car? Is it your fault because your house is painted black and the car couldn't see it? But whose fault is it? It should be really important that there's always a legal chain of things. And there's loads of debate going on right now. And there's some good examples about, you know, the autonomous car's driving down the road. A child steps out. The car knows it can't stop. Does the car decide to hit a tree and into you, or does it carry on going into the child? And these kind of all kind of debates, what should it do? For a human to make that choice is very hard. For a car, of course, very important. But the person who does that coding, that choice, could be legally liable for what happens. So it's a very complicated area that we're trying to work on. Okay, so I've given you a bit of a flavour of robotics generally. I want to talk more about the theme of course, we're talking about energy. And I guess one of the things that's very important for energy is kind of power stations. How do we generate energy? How do we use them? And robotics are great for doing kind of industrial inspection, repair, maintenance tasks. So just got a picture here of a nuclear power station. They're very complicated systems, lots going on. And we can use robots for the general maintenance, but also if things go wrong. So if things go wrong, as we see around the world sometimes, robots can really go in there and they can make a difference. They can really help to make things better. So I've got some examples here we're going to talk about as we go forward. So we've got nuclear power stations, of course that's nuclear energy. So one of the things there is how to understand nuclear things. There's also underwater, so underwater can be to inspect under water, it can be underwater in nuclear stations, but it's very important how do you make robots work underwater. There is a thing we're going to talk about in terms of working in explosive environments. So in mines, in some factories, there are potentially gases in the air. How can we make robots that won't cause an explosion? That's really important. How can we make sure it doesn't happen that way? And of course, I guess the final frontier exploration is space. I'll talk briefly about space and how we can make robots for that. So it's kind of nuclear, but extreme more generally. So in nuclear environments, they are, of course, by definition dangerous, even through general routine maintenance. People have to go in there, they have to change things, they have to repair things. We don't want that. Let's get all the people out of there in there. So these are examples here. So you might want to do underwater inspection of some of the things. So not only the radiation things are actually underwater, with rods and things, so you want to go in that environment. Of course, the water is incredibly toxic for radiation. You might want to transport some radioactive barrels of waste around. You might want to be looking at coolant pipes. You might want to do decommissioning. So in the UK, we have, I think, probably the world's oldest nuclear power stations. We are actively trying to take part of it down. Because they were built 50 or 70 years ago, we don't actually know exactly how they were built. So it's very dangerous. We don't know the plans of them exactly. How can we decommission them without causing accidents? It's very, very important. But also, if things go wrong, as we know, what we see on TV, how can we send robots in to try and help people, try and get the problems all out of the way? The small video I'll show you, this is a really useful thing in the Fukushima power station. So using robots quite heavily in that area to try and rescue things. So you can see here, they've got some remote control machines on the outside. They've got some kind of robots like this, so very big industrial robots to cut things. Robots going inside the heart of the reactor. Little plates, and I'll just show you some examples of the kind of things that they're doing. The actual reactor really is like a robot graveyard now. It's full of robots that just haven't made it. You'll see that in a few minutes. They go in there, they last for a little while, and they blow up. But these are all the new robots they've been working on. They're mobile robots that can do things, can manipulate things in the environment. So here's an example of the actual reactor building. I'm going to show you here, this robot here was used in that particular thing. This is a commercial robot called Padlock. You can buy this. Often military used by the Americans, but also other things. You can see here it's driving through in a nuclear environment. If you were to walk through the environment here, you'd probably die. It's very, very high, potentially very high radiation. So it's taking photographs of what's happening, also measuring radiation, so you're doing radiation mapping. So you have mapping of the area in terms of the physical space, but also every part of the environment has radiation measurements. So this is kind of a surface of radiation. This kind of stuff here is strange, this is like stuff on the floor. Really highly radioactive sludge. The robot there can mop it up, stick it in the basket, and that reduces some of the radiation that shouldn't be there, since there's been through the accident. So it's quite a subtle thing, but that's what it looks like mud, but that would be fatal, you just think that surely. Other robots here, quite a nice robot here. So you can drive around, it can go up and upstairs, so of course, quite often these can go upstairs, you can go around different stairs, go do different things. It's quite a big robot, human-sized robot. Climbing upstairs, the sentinel. Obviously it's doing mapping going on here, looking at what's going on. So lots of computer vision to work out what's actually happening in that environment. See here, all the to do. Little over here, we've got a rubbing around this number up here. So it looks kind of fine. You look at it and go, well, why couldn't I go in there? Why couldn't I walk in there? But the apartment's full of radiation, so these have different poles in here that you can go and inspect to see what's going on. Look, one more and I'll move on. Little robot here, kind of a similar kind of line here, with flippers at the front. You can drive around, you can do things. They're taking photographs of certain rooms, and making the radiation go to these rooms. So yeah, I'm going to give you a flavour of the kind of thing that we're going on here. As I said before, the site is really a robot graveyard. There are photographs of just like rows and rows of robots that have just died. Most of them made it back to the where they should be buried. Effectively, they just stopped there and turned them off. Some of them have died during the actual exploration, if you like, left them dead there, so radiation has killed them. There's some examples here that have not been in there, and there are sorts of quadrupeds in there, which is quite interesting, walking around with legs. So I'm going to talk briefly, hopefully not too broadly, about what happens with radiation. So radiation, of course, it kills human tissue. It can have effects on physical, mechanical structures. So bits of metal, bits of other kind of structures, obviously incredibly strong. But over a period of time, maybe 30 years or so, it can affect how strong that metal is. And that's quite important. If you're going to do decommissioning, you're going to go in there and cut it away. It's important to know it could be quite brittle. If you put a force on it, it could crack. So the radiation, although it doesn't effectively melt it, it does change its properties and it can make it more brittle. Like a pencil, you snap, basically the metal, which metal would normally bend, because of the radiation, it becomes more brittle and it could snap when you're doing things. So that's quite important. So we have to think about the kind of materials and how they're affected. Really for robots, we're talking about breaking for a short period of time, at most a month, I guess. So this kind of mechanical hardening, not important for that, but it is important for things you make for like water tanks used in nuclear reactors. Also you have things like here, glues. So glues that are put together, we're going to make robots, metals are okay. You think about glues, different kinds of glues behave differently. And of course the worst case scenario, you glue it on, it comes apart, that's bad. So you need to think about how the glues react to certain radiation doses. Motors, of course motors are things that can spin around. Motors are mostly okay. But motors do contain a combination of metals, of lubricants, some potentially organic materials like our bodies, and of course these things fail. So mostly in a motor, what fails is a bearing. So a bearing is a thing that you put a metal shaft through and it spins around, designed to give very low, smooth operation. What you find is in radiation, this kind of oil or glue, lubricant, starts to get thick. Gets thick, it slows it down, causes damage. So we have to think about motors. Some parts are good, some parts not so good in that environment. Sensors generally are pretty good. So most sensors like things that measure magnitude, for example, are pretty good. Cameras can be quite good. But cameras like glass is bad. Glass can become discolored. So although your camera might function, what you find is you can't see anything through the glass, which is a problem. So in nuclear power stations, there are different ways we can do this. We want to make a robot for a nuclear power station. The first one is we operate it remotely, so somehow we have a mechanical situation. So we're sitting on one side, and there is no electronics. So all of the things on the hot side, or the hot side where the radiation is, are mechanical levers, cables, and all of the electronics is out of the hot zone. So a very long system, a tube, with pulleys, like a puppet effectively. You're puppeteering it, so in the radiation zone, there is no kind of electronics. Outside. That's one way of doing it. Another way of doing it is, let's make a really good robot that can withstand radiation. This is really expensive. I've shown you before all the different things that can go wrong with metals and things. If you want to make a robot that's guaranteed to withstand radiation, it's incredibly expensive, a big problem. So you can do that. I guess for some examples you could do that. Mostly, one thing I should say is, so also you can shield it. So we've all seen films where you have this lead. There are certain materials that block radiation. We can build a robot and cover it in lead. By definition, to restrict radiation requires density, heavy materials. So we end up with a robot that's a huge, massive, heavy thing, very cumbersome. So shielding mostly is not a big thing. Potentially you could shield some sensitive components, but shielding all the systems is a bad thing. So most of what we're doing right now, really, is actually, we send it in there, sacrificial robots. Let's take a commercial toy, maybe it costs £300, we'll stick it in there, we know it's going to fail after 3 hours, okay, we'll send another one in. So rather than having £100,000, maybe £1 million UK, a very, very expensive robot, we end up with robots that cost pocket money, and we just keep throwing in there. Of course, the downside of that is the fact that these robots become radioactive waste. We end up with a nuclear power station full of other bits of robots that are all damaged and melted, and at some point, someone's going to have to go back in there and remove them. So, different ways of doing things. The business model, mostly at the moment, is on these very, very cheap robots. Because in the short term, that's cheap, that's good. But at some point in the future, you're going to have to recover them, and that's not so good. So, that's a nuclear thing. I mentioned about another thing about explosive-proof things. So, potentially in power stations or other places, there could be combustible gas in the air. I want to talk briefly about how we can make robots. They're called explosion-proof robots. That doesn't mean the robot itself is really strong, it can withstand a missile strike. What it means is the robot will not cause an explosion. So it sits there, the air's full of gas, it's not going to cause the whole building to explode. So let's look at that briefly. So I've got a video I'm going to show you about Japanese robots.
Get away with some things that are perhaps a bit less likely.
It's for cleaning the
So I'm going to show you a little video now. This video, I'm convinced, is a Zone Zero robot. So it's being used in the environment. Actually, it's being used in sewer pipes, I think, so where there could be gases to the sewers. So
that's the purpose for cleaning the internal surfaces from material sediment and incrustations. Geronto Federico SRL has designed a complete system for cleaning these dangerous and confined spaces, avoiding an entry. We're talking about the explosion-proof robot named Fuel Tank Cleaning Nomad Entry, complete with power-packed and video inspection system. The whole system is compact, easy to transport, and suitable for cleaning every type of tank.
Look, when you see it, it looks different. It looks designed to be all enclosed, and it's all with a good feel. As you see here, it's much more technological
in the way it looks. It's suitable for working in potentially explosive atmospheres. For enhanced security, the machine can be started up only after the connection of the grounding system.
So we've got grounding heads to remove sparks from the system to electricity.
The power pack is then switched on and the grounding is activated. Now it is possible for the operator to turn on the radio remote control.